those trains. And if you want to ride a steamer, normally you have to make a reservation in advance. Now, Mount Washington is the centerpiece of the presidential range of mountains here in the White Mountains. There are 9 of them all together, 4 to the north of Mount Washington, the northern presidentials up there to our left, and there are 4 to the right, the southern presidentials here to our right. We have a nice partial clearing here that's going to allow you to look across what's called the Amanoosuc Ravine there. And you see that building on the ridgeline over there. On the other side of that building are 2 small lakes called the Lakes of the Clouds. And you see the river running down directly below the building. That's the Amanoosuc River. It comes out of those Lakes of the Clouds. And it's the same river that flows under our bridge down at the space station. The building is called the Lakes of the Clouds Hut. It's a hiker's hut. And you can only get there by walking. It's operated by the Appalachian Mountain Club, and they operate 8 of these huts throughout the high peaks of New Hampshire. All of them are situated along the Appalachian Trail, about a half a day's hike apart, more or less. Each one is equipped with a full kitchen and bunk rooms, so if you're up here hiking in the mountains, you can make a reservation and spend the night in one of these huts, have a nice hot dinner and breakfast, prepared and served by college students who crew these huts. Believe it or not, that little building there sleeps 90 people, wow. 90, in bunk rooms, triple-decker bunks. It sounds like they pack them in. Pretty much they do. But it's a really popular experience and a unique one. And they sell out that hut most nights of the season, which just began last week and goes through till just after Labor Day. We got some people walking down the mountain, not quite sure where they came from. All of the presidential mountains are named for U.S. presidents with the exception of 2, one of which is that peak right up there to our left. That's Mount Clay, and that's named for Henry Clay, 19th century statesman and Kentucky senator. Mount Jefferson is the peak immediately to the left there. Third tallest mountain in New Hampshire, corresponding to the third presidency. The other non-president presidential mountain is Mount Franklin, that one you might have noticed there with all the snow slides on it and the pointy summit. That's named for Ben Franklin. So we're coming up to the switch here where we return from double track to single track. We'll have to pause a moment and let this train get through the switch before they throw it back in our favor, and then we'll be on our way. Just be a moment or two. As these trains pass by, you can take a look underneath the locomotive, and you can see the cog wheels, how they engage the rack to propel the train, as I was explaining earlier. There you can see the switch moving now, right in front of us.
Oh wow, look at that. It's good.
Just flag at Joe to let him know that the switch is locked into place and it's safe for us to proceed across. And one of the things you might notice as we're climbing the mountain is the trees getting shorter steadily as we go. And they'll disappear altogether at 5,000 feet just below the ridgeline up there. And just a little further than where we are now is where the deciduous trees will disappear. These white birches here to our left, they're just starting to bloom. And they'll give way to the conifers, mainly balsam firs you see here on the right. And these are particularly weathered. You see the beating they take from the wind, even at this elevation. Washington's summit is basically surrounded by a series of ridges and ravines, alternating ridges and ravines all the way around the mountain. Our tracks are going right up one of those ridges. So we've got ravines on either side, the Amanusic Ravine, as I pointed out, to our right and south. This one here to our left is called Burt's Ravine, B-U-R-T. It's named for Henry Burt. Back in the 19th century, Henry Burt published a newspaper from the summit of Mount Washington. It was called Among the Clouds, and that was a daily newspaper delivered every morning down these tracks, but not on a train. It was on a sled or a slide board called a devil's shingle, and you can see one of them on display in our museum at the base station when you get back if you didn't see it already. The devil's shingles were developed by the original track crew, the guys that built the railway back in the 1860s. And as they got further up the mountain building the tracks, they got increasingly impatient to get home at night. And they didn't want to wait for the slow trains to bring them back down. So they developed a faster way called a devil's shingle, which was basically just a piece of wood that they sat up on top of, had two little rudimentary hand brakes and a device that affixed to the rack, and they could ride this thing down the rails. And reportedly the fastest trip from summit to base on a devil's shingle, remember it's 3 miles, was 2 minutes and 45 seconds.
Wow.
And then somebody tried to break that record, and that did not end well. So not surprisingly, shortly thereafter, the devil's shingles were outlawed by the state of New Hampshire, the live free or die state. Halfway house here on the right, it's just about halfway to the summit. Take a look at our reflection in the window as we go by. You can see how steeply we're climbing the mountain because that building is perfectly level. It's a 19th century relic. Its original purpose was to store wood, which fueled the locomotives before they converted to coal. And also back then, it had another purpose. All the trains made a stop there on the way up the mountain. And that is because the coaches were open air back then. There were no coaches, windows or sides to them. And so they stopped there and they distributed blankets to the passengers so they could remain warm for the rest of the trip to the summit. I bet you're glad you live in the 21st century. Now, just ahead, just to the right of the train here, you're going to see a little rock object with a white background behind it. It's an amazing likeness of the Old Man of the Mountain, which is the state symbol of New Hampshire. You see it on our quarters, license plates, and highway signs. The original Old Man of the Mountain was a much larger rock formation that hung from the cliffs of Cannon Mountain in Franconia Notch. And when viewed from a particular angle, it looks like the profile of an old man's face. And this one remarkably looks just like it, but it's completely natural, like the original. Nobody chiseled anything to form the face. Wow. Here you can see it. Forehead up top, the nose sticking out, there's a little notch for the mouth. Yeah. And that very square, sharp, protruding jaw at the bottom makes it look a little like Jay Leno. He was here a couple of years ago, he rode the cog and he got to see himself in the mountains. Now, just ahead here, perhaps the most dramatic part of the trip. This is a 300-foot long trestle called Jacob's Ladder. It rises to 30 feet off the ground, and it's at 4,725 feet of elevation. It's the steepest part of the railway at a grade of 37.41%. To illustrate the steepness of that grade, if you can see how I'm standing now, my feet are inside the doorway, my head's outside the doorway, and I'm standing perfectly vertical. The plumb bob proves it. Wow. And if you folks here in the aisle, you can certainly feel that in your legs. The people in the front row are 14 feet higher than the people in the back row. And Jacob's Ladder also gives us one last view across the Amanoosuc Ravine to the right, links of the Clouds Hut, and the Southern Presidentials, Mounts Monroe and Franklin right there. The trees are reduced to dwarfed scrub pines. They only grow a few feet tall. It's the best they can do at this elevation, but they're completely mature trees.
That is crazy. Look at they're in the sky.
And any of you that have a problem with heights, I strongly recommend not looking down to the left. So you get a nice view all the way down to the floor of Birch Ravine down there. That's about 850 feet down. And if you look beyond Birch Ravine, across the ridge and across the valley out beyond, where the hills and mountains start rising up again at the other end of the valley, is the Connecticut River Valley. So that's the border between New Hampshire and Vermont.